as we come together, as we have proceeded, let us now look to Scripture for the comfort we get from these words that are given to us as God's revelation, God's wisdom, His strength, His knowledge, and all that He wishes for us, His dear creatures, to know. First coming, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 through 17, which says, "And I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has enabled me, because He counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, although I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and an insolent man. But I obtained mercy, because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceedingly abundant with faith and love, which are in Christ Jesus. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. However, for this reason I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show all long-suffering as a pattern to those who are going to believe on Him for everlasting life. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. And now let us stand for prayer. Almighty and gracious God, our Father in heaven, Thou art our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Lead us, we pray, to put our trust entirely in Thee. We come to Thee in the name of Thine only begotten and well-beloved Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, who died for our sins and rose again. Grant us, we beseech Thee, through this precious blood, peace and pardon, and joy in the Holy Ghost. And seeing that we have in Christ a high priest who can be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, may we come boldly unto Thy throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help us in this time of need. We thank Thee for the precious promises of Thy word. We praise Thee for the light of the gospel. We acknowledge Thy sovereign will and Thine infinite compassion. Be pleased, therefore, to look upon our sorrow for the sake of Thy dear Son. Enable us to hear Thy holy word, so that through patience and comfort of the Scriptures, we may have hope. Grant us the consolation and peace Holy Ghost. May we hold fast our confidence in Thy forgiving mercy and the blessed assurance of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, who bore our sins in His own body on the tree and rose from the dead and is exalted at Thy right hand. Amen. Please be seated and turn to the hymn books to hymn number 32, Great is Thy Faith.
Thank you.
John Hyden Larson, the son of Donald and Eunice Larson, was born August 9, 1966 in Fort Dodge. He was baptized and confirmed at Peace Reformed Church. John graduated from Corinth Wesley Luverne High School in 1984 and Dort College in 1988 with a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering. He was employed by Mossman Construction in Jacksonville, Florida, and Kansas City, Missouri, and later at Pella Corporation in Pella, Iowa. On April 6, 1991, he married Caroline Venstra at Sully Christian Reformed Church. They lived on a grain and cattle farm west of Harding all of their married life. John enjoyed farming, fixing, and doing construction projects with his father and his sons. His greatest joy was serving the Lord Jesus Christ and seeing his children and grandchildren grow up in the same faith. He was a member of Peace Reformed Church, where he served as a Sunday school teacher, a deacon, and an elder. John and Caroline were past members of Bright Christian Reformed Church south of Kanawha. He served on the Kanawha Christian School Board and as treasurer for the Humboldt County Cattlemen's Association. John is survived by his wife, Caroline Hardy, his mother, Eunice Larson of Livermore, and six sons, Jacob Larson and his wife, Tatiana, and their two children, James and Joshua of Laverne. Luke Larson and Marissa and their daughter, Grace of Livermore, Jed Larson of Laverne, Levi Larson and his wife, Carrie Beth, and their child due this October of Hardy, Clint Larson of Hardy, and Jack Larson of Hardy, and his three sisters, Sarah Larson of Des Moines, Liz and her husband, David Schenk of Olathe, Kansas, Sonia and her husband, Mike Knopp of Huxley, and many nieces and nephews. He was preceded in death by his father, Don, in January 8, 2024, and his father and mother-in-law, Dewey and Tilly Meenstrom. Upon reading this memorial of John Larson, we now turn to our sermon text, which can be found in Psalm 121. For those of you who wish to follow along in the Bibles located in your pews, this can be found on page 549. And we'll be reading the whole chapter of Psalm 121. Psalm 121, starting with verse 1, which says, I'll lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in, from this time forth and even forevermore. Thus says the word of the Lord. Thanks be. Every psalm has a particular purpose. This is of no surprise, I am sure, but the purpose of this psalm was to give comfort to those who were traveling. Especially in those days, traveling was a very dangerous and risky business, and the farther you went, the more danger there could be. Yet this psalm was for those going on those long journeys, and it was written to comfort the traveler, that no matter what hardships you may find on this road, God will be with you. This has been a popular psalm with those who are missionaries. David Livingston, when he went to Africa, quoted this psalm himself. The application of this psalm goes far beyond just travel. It applies for every waking moment. For has it not been said that our very life is a journey? Is it not said that we also walk on a path, and this path is compared to life? Consider Psalm chapter 16, verses 9 through 11. Therefore my heart is glad, and my glory rejoices. My flesh also will rest in hope. For you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And there you have another psalm. This time more blatantly comparing life and the path and the journey therein. And yet, this is also another psalm that points to hope in our journey in this life. This hope is the knowledge that God is our helper. God is our keeper. He is the one who preserves us. He is the one who orders our steps. And he is the one who is faithful to us. And this is a constant theme throughout many of the psalms. That of life as a journey and God preserving us through that journey. Consider also the famous passage of Psalm 23, which says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness, for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And there is a good reason why Psalm 23 is so well known. Another psalm said, I'm going on a long journey. But also, this psalm has been said at every point in life. Even at births, has been said also in deaths, but everything in between. For it rings true throughout all eternity and reaches up from Scripture to comfort us. That not only are our steps ordered, but that the Lord leads us to exactly where he wants us to be, allows us to meet the exact people he wants us to be with, allows us to love those people that he wants us to love. And by all of these circumstances, by all these works of providence, he makes us exactly the type of people we're supposed to be right here and right now. For this applies to every one of us. But note how the psalmist does not just say that this goodness and mercy stops at the end of one's life. He does not just say, well, he guides our hands and leads us where we are, and then we die and that's over. By no means. For after that, you will dwell in the house of the Lord. And for how long? Forever. Not for a little bit. Not temporarily. This is not just a pit stop before we go do something else. No. The house of the Lord is the goal. And it is for all time. Forevermore. I can cite other psalms and far more scripture on this topic. But suffice it to say that any time the Bible repeats, well, it repeats it so that we may dwell on it, that we may meditate on it. It'll be worded slightly different, perhaps, but the same goal. A house is built up all the way to the top, piece by piece, brick by brick, wood panel on wood panel, however it is constructed. It is always constructed one at a time. So too is a life, one moment at a time. And each moment is a gift. And Then after a time, he calls us home. And so in looking at how our steps are numbered, we know this: nothing is accidental. But for a particular point, for a particular purpose, that God guides and protects us, and he helps us through the harsh parts of our journey. Whether the hardest part of our life was growing up or growing old. Whether the hardest part of our life was our own temptations or watching those we love go through harsh trials. Whether the hardest part of our life is looking at the world and hating what we see, or looking in a mirror and hating what we see. Whether it is to the right hand or to the left. Whether the hardest part is simply getting up and taking the next step. God knows it. And God guides us. And with patience, he'll make a way for escape, that we may be able to bear it. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. So no matter what comes our way, even the harshest of things, it is for the purpose to make us strong. For a Christian is forged in fire. Whatever rough part in the path we walk in this life, our hands are held gently, and we are gently guided to where we need to be. And we are put where we need to be put, no shorter or longer a time than necessary, but just enough time to satisfy his will. And once we have done all that we are meant to do in this world, once we work to our uttermost, once the toil of this life is done, he calls us home. And our toil is finally finished. And we enter into that most blessed rest. And it is rest. A true rest from the labors. And we who remain have more work yet to do. But as we have read, he will not allow our foot to be moved. When we are in the Lord, he holds us close and doesn't let us go astray. For those of you who have children and find yourself constantly holding on to them, keeping them from doing something that they really should not do, perhaps you understand this the most. So God does to us, and not just when we're young, but even as we go old, even in times when we're strong at heart, and even in our most weakest moments. When we need to rest due to the weariness of our journey, we have what is said in Psalm 121, in which the psalmist writes, "He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep." Day to day, when our burden grows and our flesh grows tired, we may rest easy knowing that the Lord will never slumber, and he will ever be vigilant, always looking out for his sheep. For it was so that the shepherds back in the day, at nighttime, if there was no time to gather the sheep into a pen, the shepherd had to gather them together as best he could and watch over them all the night long. And at those times like those, it was good to have another shepherd, so one can sleep and the other may watch. But the Lord is such as that he needs no one else to watch. He stands to watch for all eternity and will not sleep, for he does not tire. And when the harshness of the journey beats down on us, Psalm 121 says this: "The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The harshness of the rays shall not beat upon your brow, nor the terror of the night with only but moonlight to guide you by will not tempt you to fear." He makes it so that we can continue this travel. And he will be the lamp unto our feet and the light upon our path. As Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 32 says, "Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weakness. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings, which cannot be uttered. Now he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good, to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? And as we have read, the Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Every time this comfort is given, we can expect that other word, forever, to be close on its heels. We are still sinners, and we do stumble, and we do fall. We are burdened by our imperfections. We are blinded by less important things, and we trip up on our road by the blocks in our path. But God preserves us. He preserves us now, and he preserves us forever. And though we will surely fall, our hand is still being held. And he lifts us up so that we may not taste the dirt of the path, but walk straight. Never easy, but with a goal that we can be confident. But why? This is the most common question. Why do things have to happen in this particular way? Why do things have to happen at all in these so ordered ways? I can tell you, before the ministry came to be my calling, I was a student of history and studied it constantly. And one of those things that historians often say is, well, what if this changed? What if this were different? These questions may be interesting to some, but the fact is this. Events transpire because it would best show the glory of God. It fit God's good pleasure for events to be ordered in this specific way. And we may be tempted to ask, why? But we already know the answer, truly, in our heart of hearts. For it continues his purpose and it strengthens his people, which us as Christians have comforted. So the why in that regard is so that his people may be preserved in a specific way that he wants to better show his glory. But perhaps the question is not about why things happen in a particular way. Perhaps a more common question is, why does he promise us this? Why does he promise this to us again and again and again? Why does he say that we can depend on his strength? Why does he care for us? We are sinners. Is it not true that when Adam and Eve sinned, they were the only two humans on earth, and as such, all of humanity sinned? Why give us mercy? Would it not be more fair for eternal punishment for all mankind? For that is the fairness, is it not? And yet we have another famous piece of scripture, and famous for a good reason. I'm sure many of you know it. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The importance of this is not just to show that God loved us, but that in God's love for us, we will not die. Death is simply an entry to eternal life, a temporary thing. Despite everything, we as imperfect humans have done, and will do, by the way, we are still his creation. And though his justice requires a punishment for our sin, he has chosen some to save, a remnant. For indeed, again, if God would be completely fair, we would all be under punishment. But his love for his creation has made it so that he gathered together some of his people and told them the truth. Gave him peace and a promise, which we have in Jesus Christ, who died on the cross. And for these very reasons, we need not worry for the future. Fear should never be our temptation. For the opposite of love is fear. But in God, we have love, and not a shadow of doubt. But even after saying all this, such a mercy is hard to grasp, for guilt is an ever-present temptation. Yet God always fulfills his promises, even if we do not always understand it. His comfort at the end of our life is this. We can read it from Matthew chapter 23, verses 34 to 40. That the king will say to those on his right hand, "Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me." Then the righteous will answer him, the righteous being Christians, those of us apart, saying, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and gave you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and came to you?" For indeed, don't we all think that now? For Christ has already died and risen and gone to heaven. We have not done any of these things to him. How can God say that we have? And then we continue in Scripture, which says, "And the king will answer and say to them, 'Assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren, did it to me.'" One of the blessings that we have is that God so moves our hearts so that we can perform it. Guides our hands to those works, to our fellow believers, but also to elsewhere, to other people, everywhere as we can. By the love that God has shown us, we do have a guide to what love is and what it should be. And love shown to others so that we bask in the joy eternal. For God moves in our heart and gives us knowledge as Christians what we need to do. It isn't always easy, and that indeed it is often hard. Is it not true that to be Christian is to suffer? And yet whatever suffering we have in this life, whether emotional or physical, it cannot harm our soul. For God preserves it forever and keeps us to the end. As Psalm chapter 34, verses 17 through 18 says, "The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears, and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to those who have a broken heart, and saves such as have a contrite spirit. For if your heart is broken, and your heart in the depths of mourning, God sees that too, and will come beside you, and prosper you. Guide your heart, though it suffers for a time, to a joy that does not just last for a day or for two, but for eternity. Though we are tempted to forget it in sorrow and in fear, for us it is but a temporary thing, as long as we are moved by the Holy Spirit and desire earnestly to pray every day. He will grant it to us, and he will give us peace. When we are alive, we belong to Christ, and when we are dead, we still belong to Christ, who purchased us with his blood, who is himself the conqueror of death and the giver of the promise of eternal life. For a life lived, whether short or long, is not wasted when we are in the Lord, but always used to its fullest and used for God's glory. For when it is time to give up our life, we merely return that which was given to us. And when that time comes, the part of the parable that Jesus told concerning the servants and the talents that were lent to them come to mind, which we will close our service with, Matthew 25, verse 21, which says, "His Lord said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I'll make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord.'" The joy without ceasing, the joy eternal. So it was, so it is, so it shall forever be. Amen. Now let us turn to our hymnals, to hymn number 691. It is well with my soul. The consolation of the sorrowful, and the support of the weary, who does not delight in grieving or afflicting the children of men, look down in tender love and pity, we beseech thee, upon thy servants, the bereaved household, whose joy is turned into mourning, and according to the multitude of thy mercies, be pleased to uphold, strengthen, and comfort them, that they may not faint under thy fatherly chastening, but find in thee their strength and refuge. We thank thee for all that thou hast provided for us. We thank thee for the food in which we will partake, and the fellowship which we will have also. Bless us, O Lord, in our conversation with one another, that in the words of thy scripture we may edify one another, strengthen one another, and give peace to each other, O Lord. Use us as tools of thy will, so that we may prop each other up, as soldiers prop up each other in the midst of war. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Now the God of peace, that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. And let us turn to the yellow insert, which will have the hymn, When We All Get to Heaven.
Thank you.
Feel free to wait in the fellowship hall as you're dismissed, and then we'll proceed to the grave for committal.